Hello viewers, welcome to EPG Pathshala. This is Professor Srinivas Reddy, retired professor of public administration, Kakti University, Warangal, Telangana, and currently professor of business management at Aurora's Business School, Hyderabad. This module on which I am going to make a presentation is about the modes of public policy, the implementers of public policy, and the conditions for successful implementation of public policies. You must be aware that the modern state governs the people through the medium of public policies. All the people either benefit or suffer because of the right or wrong public policies respectively. So therefore it is absolutely important to see to gain some knowledge about public policies. There has been a lot of research in 1970s about public policies. As a result of this research, we have some knowledge to understand the reality of public policy. In this module, we will see what are the models of public policy, who are the actors of public policy, and what are the conditions for successful implementation of public policy.
Policy implementation is a lengthy process that begins with designing the content of a policy to achieving the end results. There are a few important dimensions and essential conditions for a successful policy implementation. This lecture primarily attempts to define policy implementation and discuss the process of policy implementation. Further, it draws upon various dimensions of policy implementation and identifies some of the important conditions for the successful implementation of a policy. Up until 1970s, policy analysts did not give much attention to policy implementation aspects. Implementation research gained significance as many policies have not been implemented successfully in the mid-1970s. Defining policy implementation. Policy implementation is an important component in the overall policy process. It's a lengthy process that begins from designing the content of a policy to achieving the end results. Implementation determines the success or failure of a policy. Petras and Beinert observed a limitation in understanding the meaning and scope of implementation. According to them, the earlier studies viewed policy implementation merely as an administrative task. It was assumed that once the policy had been legislated and approved, the implementation process would take place automatically without any further tasks. However, as they argue, this line of thought ignored or glossed over complexities involved in policy implementation. They recognized the existing ambiguity about the beginning of policy implementation and its ending. According to Buyen, Jorgensen and Sharma, their study of 2010, policy implementation primarily emphasizes the mechanisms, resources, and relationships that link policies to program action. Policies once adopted are not always implemented as envisaged at the beginning and do not necessarily achieve intended results. The literature and policy sciences defines policy implementation in various ways. To begin with, Meter and Hahn, in their 1974 work, say that policy implementation encompasses those actions by public or private individuals or groups that are directed at the achievement of objectives set forth in prior policy decisions. This definition highlights two important issues in policy implementation. First, collective nature of effort of public and private individuals, such as government officials, civil society actors, and individuals. Achievement of the objectives which are laid down in the policy content is the second issue. In a similar tone, Nakamura and Smallwood in their 1980 study understood public policy implementation as a process aimed at accomplishing the goals of a policy. They further defined policy implementation as the set of activities and operations undertaken by various stakeholders toward the achievement of goals and objectives defined in an authorized policy. Another definition of policy implementation is put forward by Petros and Bynard in 2005. They say that policy implementation is accomplishment of policy objectives through the planning and programming of operations and projects so that agreed upon outcomes and desired impacts are achieved. This definition brings an added importance to planning and programming of a policy which are aimed for target achievement. Put together, it is understood that there are three important elements that need attention vis-a-vis policy implementation. First, policy implementation is nothing but achieving the goals of a policy which are designed at the beginning. Second, policy implementation involves various actors such as government officials, civil society spokespersons, business groups, and individuals. In fact, according to Sabatier and Mosmanian 1979 study, the second element, that is, the active involvement of various stakeholders, is an important condition for successful policy implementation. Third, planning and programming of a policy are also considered to be critical in the process of implementation. Now we come to the models of policy implementation. Public policies are implemented in three different ways. These are perhaps can be defined as three modes of public policy implementation. Understanding of these will help us better implementation of public policies or better appreciation of public policies. The models of public policy implementation, as mentioned earlier, are classified into first generation model, second generation model, and third generation model. The first generation model adopts top-bottom or top-down approach to implementation of public policy. This approach believes that effective implementation requires a top-down system of control and communications and the resources to do job. It focuses on politicians and officials and examines the extent to which administrators carry out or fail to carry out the decisions of the government. It seeks to find out the reasons underlying the extent of the implementation conducted. This approach focuses on the formal relations between the actors. The second generation model applies bottom-up approach to implementation. This approach presumes that success or failure of many programs depend on the commitment and skill of the actors directly involved in the policy implementation. They are called street-level bureaucrats by Michael Lipsey. The second approach focuses its attention on both formal and informal relationships constituting the policy subsystems involved in both designing and implementing policies. It argues that the street-level bureaucrats must be taken into account. Bottom-up model lays stress on negotiation and consensus building in the public service delivery. A major limitation of both first and second generation models is that they do not analyze the behavioral aspects of policy implementation. They do not answer questions such as why do implementers behave in a particular way in carrying out their task and why specific tools and policy mechanisms are used in specific circumstances. These questions are addressed in the third generation theory of policy implementation. The third generation model of implementation or theory of implementation uses the game theory to assess the behavioral discretion of bureaucrats in policy implementation. It is easier to implement policies and decisions which are having a single factor than those having multiple factors. For instance, implementing road safety policy is easier than implementing the policy of poverty eradication. In such circumstances, the administrative officials tend to focus on easily implementable policies than on the difficult ones. This gives enough scope for them to use their discretion. Different levels of discretion lead to different regulation styles. For instance, regulators will use persuasion to make the regulated persons adhere to the rules and regulations. If that is not possible, the regulators will start using coercion. The use of coercion or force depends on the compliance of the rules by the regulator. Apart from the game theory, the third generation implementation theory uses principal-agent theory to understand how bureaucrats use their discretion in a socio-political and cultural setting. Now we come to section 2 that deals with factors and actors in policy implementation. Now first we come to factors for policy implementation. There are a few important factors that are critical in the process of policy implementation. Walt and Gilson, in their study of 1994, identified four important factors in formulation as well as implementation of a policy. They are the content of the policy, 2, the nature of the policy, 3, the actors involved in the process, and fourthly and lastly, the context in which the policy is designed and must be implemented. Effective implementation determines the success of any public policy. Implementation has to be consistent with predetermined objectives and the anticipated desired outcomes. While delineating other important factors for the success of a policy, McLaughlin, in his 1987 study, stated that there are two critical factors that contribute to the success of a policy. They are local capacity and the will or motivation to implement. Capacity of the policy implementation and the will or motivation to implement solely depend upon the implementer's response that can influence the policy. In addition to these factors, Laughlin also identified a third factor, and that is the balance of pressure and support. First, pressure is required in the process of policy implementation as it ensures the policymakers to focus attention on preparing target-oriented objectives. Second, support is also needed to enable successful implementation. McLaughlin also believed that a strategic balance of pressure and support is critical in the process of policy implementation, policy formulation, and its successful implementation. This will direct the policy implementation towards achievement of its pre-designed goals. In a similar vein, Buyen, Jorgensen, Sharma, in their 2010 study, emphasized that identifying barriers to policy implementation and addressing them will significantly affect the success of a policy. Effective policy implementation ensures quality of delivery and reduces inconsistencies among service providers. In sum, it can be said that effective policy implementation is critical for policy with which its success can be ensured. The actors of policy implementation. Theoretically speaking, politicians play significant role in overseeing and evaluating the policy implementation. However, they are largely dependent on bureaucrats in this exercise. Sometimes, policy implementation is also supplemented by the non-governmental officials. Hollett and others in their 2009 study identifying the following actors as involved in policy implementation. They are civil servants, number one. Number two, quasi-governmental organizations, shortened for convenience as QANGOs. QANGOs may range from state-owned enterprises, non-profit corporations and bodies, and public-private partnerships. Besides, other state agencies also take part in policy implementation, and they include tribunals, administrative appeal boards, public hearings, specialized advisory boards, and commissions. Now, we focus on different dimensions of policy implementation. There are as many as 7 important dimensions in implementation of a public policy, starting from policy formulation to the achievement of end results. The first dimension involves the policy content, its formulation, and its dissemination. The second dimension involves understanding the socio, political, and economic context in formulating the policy and setting forth the objectives. This dimension is an important factor because it influences the nature or type of policies to be framed and implemented. In order to achieve the pre-designed policy objectives, the implementers should take into consideration issues such as gender inequality and governing processes, economic conditions, and social environment. The third dimension recognizes the role of leadership in policy implementation. A strong and committed leadership can receive coordination and cooperation from his or subordinates. Such leaders can ensure accountability and responsibility in leading policy implementation. They can communicate effectively about the policy goals and the rationale of the policy. They can build consensus among his or her team members and other policy stakeholders with regard to the content of a policy and its how far it contributes for an effective implementation. The fourth dimension emphasizes the involvement of various stakeholders in policy implementation. Stakeholders include civil society organizations, business groups, private entrepreneurs, and individuals responsible for implementation. They bring diverse perspectives, skills and resources, knowledge in policy implementation. It's also worth mentioning that the involvement of various stakeholders ensures transparency and accountability from the policy implementers. To put it briefly, a policy designed by the policymakers involving stakeholders will be more meaningful. The fifth dimension is proper planning and resource mobilization. Proper strategy and action plans, sufficient budget and operational directives are important links between policy formulation and actual implementation. The sixth dimension refers to the operations and services. Operational and service levels involve coordination with other organizations, which may have both positive and negative effects on service delivery. The seventh and the last dimension is receiving feedback on progress and end results of policy implementation. It's very important to assess the progress of a policy and its end results. This helps in modifying the existing policy or formulating new policies. Apart from these seven dimensions, Sebashier and Masmanian in their 1979 work listed out a few important conditions for effective policy implementation. According to them, under these conditions, policy decision seeks a substantial departure from the status quo. Further, they stated that these conditions ensure that the achievement of the targets without any major changes. Now we come to the section 4 of the lecture that dilates on important conditions for the effective implementation of public policy. Following are the five conditions that are essential in order to make the policy implementation effective. The first condition is that the program should be based on a sound theory relating to changes in target group behavior in the achievement of the desired end states or objectives. This condition emphasizes two issues. First, the program of a policy should be supported with proper theoretical framework or a theory. Second, the decisions of a policy should be based upon the achievement of the desired objectives. It's important to see that the target groups comply with the goal of policy. Second, the statute or the basic policy decision should be unambiguous or very clear. Besides, policy directives and structures of the implementation should ensure the target groups will perform as desired. The second condition primarily focuses on policy formulators and offers a few suggestions while formulating policies. This condition is that the objectives and decisions of a policy should be precise and clearly stated. Further, sufficient financial resources should be made available to the implementing agencies. This facilitates hiring the required staff, technical advocacy, and monitoring of the target group compliance. Third, the leaders of the implementing agencies should possess substantial managerial and political skills and are committed to statutory goals. The third condition advocates substantial managerial and political skills by the leaders of the implementing agencies. Policy support is useless if it is not accomplished by political and managerial skill in utilizing available resources. The authors believe that political skill ensures the ability to develop good working relationships with the agency subsystems. Managerial skill involves developing adequate control on fiscal management, maintaining high morale among agency personnel, and managing internal dissent. Fourth, the program is actively supported by organized constituency groups and by a few key legislators or the chief executive throughout the implementation process, and the court should be neutral or supportive. The fourth condition appears to be an important one, which strongly advocates for active political support by the constituency group and by a few key legislators in the process of achieving their predetermined objectives. Apart from these, this condition urges that the courts remain neutral and support throughout the implementation process. Fifth, the relative priority of statutory objectives is not significantly undermined over time by the emergence of conflicting public policies or by changes in relevant socio-economic conditions that undermine the statute's technical theory or a political support. The last condition emphasizes that the policy program shall not be undermined by changing socio-economic conditions. The continuous support from key legislators, constituency members, civil society groups, and implementing officials are crucial right from policy formulation to implementation. If all these conditions are met, then any policy, no matter how ambitious it is or how big in scale it is, it will be effectively implemented.
Friends, we have now come to the concluding part of the lecture on public policy modes, implementers, and conditions for the success of public policies. There are different modes of public policy implementation, as was found out during the research in 1970s in the context of failure of large number of public policies. There is top-down approach, there is bottom-up approach, and there is a hybrid approach also. There are different actors participating in public policies. In the earlier view of public policy, the actors were narrowly conceived as politicians and bureaucrats, but in addition to them, there are so many people who play a role in public policy implementation. There are the business lobbies, the civil society organizations, the political parties, pressure groups, and some powerful individuals. And one must take note of so many variety of factors who are shaping the public policy implementation. And some favorable conditions are also needed for public policy implementation. They may be like the conducive socio-political and economic environment, the support of the political elites, the support of the courts, and the proper implementation, proper planning and implementation of public policies. With this, we conclude this lecture on modes of public policy, the actors of public policy, and conditions for successful implementation of public policies. Thank you.